14, my son Michael, 15. I 16. Well, 15, 15. He just turned 16. Thanks to you all. Thanks for coming.
Sure, thank you.
Well, I started them.
We'll make it a whole picnic. Here's your community elements. You guys go. Here's your community elements.
It's because he's Swiss. He's not celebrating.
Pastor? Oh, we got more balloons here. Okay. that the video? It looks like we have our congregation together. Thank you for coming. Make yourselves comfortable. There's some chairs here if you need to. This is a traditional call and response to start things. Your response on every one is going to be, His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
His love endures forever.
To Him who alone does great wonders.
His love endures forever.
Now, who by His understanding made the heavens and spread out the earth upon the waters?
His love endures forever.
That's the truth. Who made the sun to govern the day and the moon and stars to govern the night?
His love endures forever.
He remembered us in our low estate, down in the valley.
His love endures forever.
Who freed us from our enemies.
His love endures forever.
He gives food to every creature.
His love endures forever.
So everyone, please, give thanks to the God of heaven.
His love endures forever.
I invite you to stand, if you will, as we sing together.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He's the above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm,
worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy. Hallelujah. God is awesome, isn't he? He's filled with awestruck wonder. He's a marvelous mystery. We praise his name and praise God for this praise team. We thank you for that beautiful worship, lifting up our voices to God today. Well, now it's time for our kids' message. We welcome all the kids who are here in person. Any kids can come down front. If you feel like a kid today, you're welcome to join us down front too. We welcome all the kids who are online. And we're thinking especially of Lisa and Daisy. They're with their mom, Kaidi. We miss all of you. You're in Estonia right now. We wish you a happy 4th of July from across the pond. We also miss Sophia and Mia and Sophia and also Noah and Tyler. We miss all you kids, but we wish everybody a happy 4th of July today. So we're celebrating the 4th of July. And what is the 4th of July? We celebrate, what are we celebrating, kids? It begins with an F. Independence Day, yes, what else? Freedom. We're celebrating our freedom, right? So we sing 245 years ago today in the year, do you know what the year was? 1776, a long time ago, right? We became a free nation with the signing of the Declaration of Independence. And our country was founded on godly principles. God has blessed our nation in many ways over the years. He blesses those who follow him and who walk in his ways. So today we're going to talk about thou art holy. What does it mean to be holy? Anybody want to consider what does it mean to be holy? Yes, Diana. Yes, to be in the spirit. Oh, I love that. Yes, being holy is being in the spirit, in God's spirit, right? Because God is the Holy Spirit. And he said, we are spirit also. Well, it also means to be sacred, to be set apart for a special purpose, to be pure, without sin or stain. Is anybody here without sin or stain? Oh my, maybe not yet, right? But we are dedicated to God and there's someone who can help us with that. Well, oftentimes we use the color white to demonstrate holiness. You see a lot of white? We put a lot of white out here because white is pure and holy. There's no color added to it, right? And the Bible says that God is holy. We know that we're not so holy that we sin against God, and we don't always follow what he says. We do make mistakes, but God sent someone to wash away our sins. Who came to set us free from our sins? Who is that? Yes. Yes. Jesus came to set us free from all of our sins. He died on the cross to forgive us, to pay the price for our sins. When we believe in him, Michael and Naomi, get ready. When we believe in Jesus, then we are made holy. We are promised a place in heaven with Jesus when we are made holy through him. We just have to believe in him, believe that he paid for our sins. All right. Oh my goodness, who is that coming in? Who's making an entrance? This is Jesus coming in on his throne. We must worship him, for he is holy. Let's take our white banners and we're going to worship Jesus. We're going to come and worship around him with our white banners, right? The Bible says that when we get to heaven, we will worship him forever and ever. And we're supposed to start right here on earth, right? We're supposed to start worshiping him right here. We're supposed to worship God and Jesus at all times in everything that we say and do, because Jesus died to set us free. Also, why don't you bring those gold crowns? It says we're going to lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. So bring those crowns forward. Lay them at the feet of Jesus, because he died to give us real freedom. Real freedom comes only through Jesus. So today we celebrate being free in Jesus and being a nation that is free. Hallelujah. Let's pray. We're going to have some fun activities later. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we bow down. We bow down, for thou alone art holy, God. Thou alone are without sin or stain. Thou alone are free from sin, and you set us free. Thank you, Jesus, that you are the King of kings and Lord of lords, and we have freedom through you, Jesus. We have freedom from all sin and all affliction. We thank you that you heal us, that you give us eternal life with you in heaven. Help us, Father, to walk with you. Help us to be free from the temptation of the enemy. Thank you, Lord, that you cleanse us. You wash us from our sins. So come now, Jesus. Make us all holy. Make us pure in your sight. Make us white as snow. Help us all to lay our crowns at your feet. Lord, help us to lay our crowns and to trust in you, to walk with you. We pray you bless all the children here at church, throughout our community, Father, throughout our country and around the world. We pray your blessings upon every child. And Lord, every one of us is made in your image. We are all made to be holy. We are all made to walk without sin. So help us with that, Father. We're all your children. We pray your blessings upon our church and the service. And thank you, Lord, that you are here with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, can I get Josephine and Zara to come on up here? Last week we brought in 5 new members of our church, and one person couldn't make it. So Josephine is here to take to answer the questions that everybody else did. Okay. So these are the questions. Do you acknowledge yourself to be a sinner in the sight of God and without hope for your salvation except in his sovereign, God's sovereign mercy? If so, please say, I do. Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and depend on him alone for your salvation as is he is offered to us in the Gospels? If so, please say, I do. Do you now promise and resolve in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes a follower of Christ? If so, I do and will with God's help. Okay, good. Do you promise to serve Christ in his church by supporting and participating with this congregation in its service of God and its ministry to others to the very best of your ability? If so, please say, I do. Do you submit yourself to the government and discipline of our church and to the spiritual oversight of this church session? And do you promise to promote the unity, purity, and peace of the church? If so, please say, I do. Okay. We have another new church member. Praise God.
Good morning and welcome. Morning. Hey, I've got a few visual aids I'm going to show you real quickly. Here's some communion elements. If you don't have any, raise your hand and maybe somebody will bring you some. And if you're online on live stream, you might want to get those things ready as well. And the other visual aid is a program, which is right here.
Robin.
The program's got the memory verse in there plus all our songs, so make sure you get that too. Okay, so much for those. Another visual aid is over at the table over there. There's flowers over there. And there's a person by the name of Poppy that brings those, and she's from Sachet. I think she owns Sachet Floral. And it's also her birthday today. So let's wish her a happy birthday on 3. 1, 2, 3. Happy birthday, Poppy. All right. And I've got a grandson at home. He's 4 today. So he's got a birthday, too. His name's Ragnar. All right, you can connect with us if you got your phone ready. No, I'm just kidding. But you look on unionpc.org and also on the Connect with Us button, and you can look for the connection card, fill out some information, get your weekly emails, and also put prayer requests and a lot of other things there. We've got another meeting scheduled for July 18th after the service. It's our congregational meeting. And the purpose of the meeting is to elect some new session elders. All right. And let's see what we got else. That's outdoor worship. Okay, we're doing that right now, but we're going to do it again on August 1st. Today's Independence Day for the United States. August 1st is Independence Day for Switzerland. Just to let you know, because I was born there. So bring your lawn chairs and maybe your Alphorns or whatever. Okay, looking for a place to serve and don't know where? Sign up to serve during the fellowship hour. So it's only an hour, really. We're looking for a few people each week to help with the coffee and cleanup. More specific details are in the weekly email. Please contact Chris Amon if you'd like to serve in this way. Okay, live stream. So you're aware live stream will continue to stream each Sunday as it did before the pandemic. So we're over the pandemic, I hope. Share the link with your friends and sign up to receive notifications. If you're on vacation or missed a Sunday or worship, this is a great way to catch up. You can catch up for a whole year if you want. You can binge watch. Okay, we got our Bible verse for July. So if you can look in your programs, and I think it's on the second page down at the bottom. So go ahead and recite it with me. It's from Romans 10, verses 9 through 10. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Okay, one more announcement. We're going into offering here. So as part of worship, we continue to give back to God, because everything belongs to him anyway, out of the blessings he has given us. At this time, we invite the ushers to come forward to pass the plates. I don't know if they're chinette or whatever kind, or buckets. Okay, we've got buckets. We're going to have buckets of money after, hopefully. If you're at home, you're welcome to mail your check to the church, and don't make it out to Pastor Dave, okay? Make it out to Union Presbyterian Church. Otherwise, he'll be driving a Ferrari pretty soon. Who knows? Okay. And I'd like to remind you that 22% of the money that you give to the church goes to missions, both locally and worldwide. So thanks for coming.
Hey, Ed, can you come here for a second? So I wanted you all to hear something. So this is a letter I got, and you might remember this person. It says, Dear Pastor Moore, I'm sending this check because I feel God has led me to send this thank offering to Union Presbyterian Church for the foundation it gave me for my faith back in the late 70s in the youth groups, such as WAYG and TAYG. The Bible teachings I received then under the leadership of people such as Conrad Hopkins and Beverly Richards and others whose names I don't remember. Sorry for my poor handwriting. God has not gifted me with great handwriting, but he has gifted me with his son, Jesus Christ, my loving Savior. Thanks again to Union Presbyterian Church. And it's signed Victor. Victor Haskett, if that name rings a bell. Unfortunately, he actually did make the check out to Pastor David Moore. So there's my offering, and let me give you $200. So everyone's witnessing this. All right.
We trust you, man.
There we go. So I'm going to keep the check now. I'm going to cash it, and we're all cool. Is that okay?
It's on video.
It's on video.
We'll just do it this way. We do need to send them a thank you note, though, of some sort. Do you want to take that? Okay, good. Thank you. All right. So as you know, we are this summer going through, oh my gosh, I messed up already. How did I do that? Oh, there it is. So the Old Testament reading, the Old Testament reading is from Revelation. It says this, is Revelation 4 verses 1 to 11. After this, I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And the voice I had first heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this." At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and ruby. A rainbow that shone like an emerald encircled the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. In front of the throne, seven lamps were blazing. These are the seven spirits of God. Also in front of the throne, there was what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. In the center around the throne were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in back and in front. The first living creature was like a lion, the second like an ox, the third had a face like a man, and the fourth was like a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under its wings. Day and night they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and who is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and say, "You are worthy, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." So this summer, we're looking at the different attributes of God. And I was thinking about this and what I was going to talk about today. A while ago, I was interviewing a youth pastor to come here and be the pastor for youth after Pat Grover left. And I was just meeting him. Pat had recommended him. And we were in my office, and somebody else was there. And so I just asked him, I said, "Tell me about God." And he said, "God is love." I said, "Excellent, that's great. What else?" And there didn't seem to be much else that this person knew about. And I think part of the reason was that in his development and his learning about God, he had been in a denomination that's much more liberal, even than the PCUSA. And so what he had learned about God was that God was love, which is absolutely true. God is love. But God's also more than love. There are many other attributes of God. And the attribute that I hold in tension with love that I pointed out to this young man was holiness, that God is holy. And unfortunately, I never learned his opinion about the holiness of God, because after the conversation, he let me know he really wasn't interested in the position anymore. And I honestly think it would have been a stretch for him to come on our staff and a stretch for us to be with him. Because I think the idea of God being holy was not how he wanted to understand God. He was very used to a God who simply loved. And everything everyone does is just fine. Nothing insults God. Nothing disappoints God. Nothing angers God. God is love. Which I think is a stunted and erroneous understanding of exactly who God is. Because God's also holy. So today we're in Isaiah 6, verses 1 through 13. "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings, and with two wings they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorpost and the threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe is me," I cried, "for I am ruined. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me." He said, go and tell this people, be hearing, but never understanding. Be seeing, but never perceiving. Make the heart of this people calloused. Make their ears dull and close their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn and be healed. Let me pray for us. Jesus, thank you for this word. Thank you for helping us understand you better and better. Lord, I pray that all of us would get to know you better through this series, for this time, that you would bless our fellowship today, that you would always use our lives to bring you glory. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The main task of a Christian is to know God. Everything starts with that. Any event in life, any season that you're in, good or bad, God can use it to teach us about ourselves and, more importantly, about him. I mean, if you go through marital challenges, you'll learn about yourself, but you'll also learn about God. And perhaps as you're going through challenges like that, you can honestly say, I don't know what the specific reason is that I'm going through these marital challenges, or maybe it's a job difficulty or a difficult relationship. But I do know, we all know, that the general, most basic purpose for everything in life is so I can know God better. God tends in Scripture and in our lives, he doesn't just say, "I'm like this," but rather through his actions, he shows us what he's like. And what I mean is this. Abraham learns that God will always provide. Remember that Abraham has Isaac, and they're right on top of the mountain. He's about to sacrifice Isaac, and God tells him, "You know what? I am Jehovah Jireh. I provide. I am the God who provides." When the Israelites needed water, when they were going through the desert, and God takes a polluted lake and he heals it, and he changes the water, and he tells them, "I am Jehovah Rapha, the one who heals." And when the Israelites are about to fight a battle later on, he tells them, "I'm Jehovah Nisi. I am your victory." See, a mature Christian can look back on their life and say, during those hard times, this is what God was teaching me about himself. This is what he wanted me to know. And because Christians can look backwards with clarity, we can also look forward and anticipate that he'll be with us, that his presence will never leave us, that his goodness is still good, his faithfulness is intact. And it enables us always to move forward in faith because we know better who God is. So today we're looking at holiness, God's holiness. And I think it does four things. I think it overwhelms us. I think it strips us. I think it heals us, and it renovates us. So the first thing is that it overwhelms us. The seraphs are repeating the word holy, which means separate. It means, or more literally, it means cut. It means separated above us. God's a cut above. He is infinitely exalted. He is other. And when we get a glimpse of his holiness, we realize that he is beyond us in every way. He is so good. He is so powerful. He is so correct. He is so whole. He is not broken like we are. When you understand who God is, we come to the realization that his perfection and purity is such that we can't argue with him. We can't complain to him. We can't trifle with him. We can't ignore him, and we can't question him. And we do all those things until we really comprehend God, until we see his holiness. And his holiness puts all that stuff beyond us. He is beyond us Full stop. And when we realize how truly holy God is, we're filled with a mix of emotions. It's mainly fascination and fright. I think that's the way that we approach anything that's beyond us, is fascination and fright. You know, when you watch movies where an alien comes in, the alien is always approached with fear and fascination because they've done something we can't do. They've traveled to us, and so we approach with guns at the ready always because we are fearful and fascinated. Now, I want you to think about that alien being absolutely holy, the very definition of holy, such that in its presence, you are always reminded how unworthy, how unholy you are. How would you approach a being like that? Well, carefully, right? I mean, it's attractive, but it's also threatening because we know a little bit of how holy we are not. And as a part of that, you know that human beings are jealous. Most of us are threatened by super competent people. We're threatened by people who are simply better than us. You know, it's been studied that people who are really confident and really competent in themselves often have to start their own businesses because if they're in a big corporation, their superiors just won't promote them out of sheer jealousy. And that tidbit comes from a book called The Peter Principle. Now, I will say it's probably not true of you, that your competence and your confidence is not the reason that you're progressing, but it is true still that jealousy stifles careers. Now think about how much better God is than us. And you think there's no jealousy there? Of course there is. We live in a society, we live in a world full of people who want to be gods themselves and don't like the idea of a Yahweh, a God who is pure and holy, who will not tolerate evil, who has even created a place for people to be away from him and his holiness if that's what they choose to do. A God who is so holy that when he was on Mount Sinai giving the law to Moses, that place where he was so holy that even if an animal set foot on the mountain, it died. See, we're uncomfortable, most of us modern people, with a God at all, much less one that's holy and other. But truthfully, if God exists, then he would need to be other. He would need to be holy in order to be worthy of worship. I mean, look at Isaiah. I mean, he never really thought of God's holiness, and then when he's given this vision of it, what happens to him? Does he rejoice? No, he despairs. Woe is me, for I've seen someone really holy. Woe is me, because I've broken the covenant. In fact, if you move forward in time, that's exactly what Jesus accuses the Pharisees of. He says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, because you've broken the covenant." When Jesus calms the storm in Mark 4, you might remember that. They're out on the lake, and a huge storm is coming, and the wind is up, and the boat is tipping over because of the pressure of the wind on the sail. And Jesus, with a word, says, "Calm down." Do you remember if the disciples were really happy that they weren't going to drown now? Do you remember that? No, they were terrified. They say, "Who is this? Who is this that even the wind and the waves obey him?" You might know historically that famous psychologists have theorized that humans invented God so that when storms like that hit, we would have somewhere to go to with our fears. Well, I think that incident with Jesus puts that theory just in the trash bin. Because they were scared of the storm, the disciples were. But they were even more scared of the person who just dismissed the storm. I mean, think about it. Christianity is a disaster if we have falsely created a God who is scarier than the thing we invented the God to control. You know, you really haven't experienced God until you've caught a glimpse of his holiness. Until you've caught a glimpse of his power and his purity, such that all your excuses and all your complaining and all your questioning of him really just makes you tired of yourself. I mean, I have no more right to question a God this good, this powerful. I have no basis for complaining. Perhaps more important than the day that we admit there is a God and that Jesus is him is the day that we realize that if God is who he says he is, then he has every right and authority and power to turn our lives completely upside down if he wants to. And we might just be along for the ride. That God is holy. Even the rocks cry out, says Jesus. Has God's holiness, like remember in the passage, it shakes the temple. Has God's holiness ever shaken your life? And I think we need to be shaken every once in a while. We need to be reminded that God is holy and we are not. And to know that though God has accommodated our sins through Christ, God is at his core pure and holy, and we aren't. And that should unsettle us. Because although things will never be fair in this world, one day this holy God of ours will right all wrongs. Justice will prevail because of who he is. He is holy. Don't get bitter, because God's justice is holy justice. And until you are overwhelmed by God, you will never be able to handle the universe that was created and run by a holy God. And I would say that God's holiness exposes us. And what I mean by this is what Isaiah says. He says, "Woe is me, I am a man of unclean lips." Remember, Isaiah's a prophet. It was his job to use his lips, his mouth, to speak God's truth. That was his job. That was his strength. That was his bragging point. But if you look at this vision, Isaiah is exposed as sinful. And the thing is, his strength, his speaking, his lips, they weren't a strength at all compared to God. See, we all have a self-esteem that's based on the things that we do well. But God's holiness, I mean, look, Isaiah was impressed with his ability to speak for God, to be chosen to do that because of the talents that he had. But seeing God in his holiness, all that self-esteem, all that braggadocio, all that stuff just falls apart. Now, for us, maybe it's our ability to engineer. It's our ability to compute, maybe, or to do business well. For the Apostle Paul, remember what his bragging point was? Remember what his glory was? It was in his ability to live a pure life, to be ritually pure. That boosted his self-esteem. That made him okay. But then perhaps one time he read "Do Not Covet" again and realized it's more than just not wanting other people's stuff. But it meant he had to love God so much that he could never be discontented and never be ungrateful in any situation. And suddenly what he thought of was his strength meant nothing compared to God's holiness. And not only that, when a person gets a more accurate whole sense of God's holiness, we realize that we never have and we never will love God the way he deserves to be loved with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength. The very best we are, best of who we are, is simply rags. You remember last Sunday I was talking about idols. The last idol. Once you've gotten all the other idols out of your life, career, family, other relationships, the last idol is self-righteousness. Everything we produce, everything we are, is filthy rags in comparison to God's holiness. Listen, we all like to be moral, and we like to compliment ourselves on being pretty good people most of the time. But really, there's nothing there to depend on. In and of ourselves, we're really nowhere close to being acceptable to God. That's why Jesus has to completely save us. Our only hope is a free grace and a complete pardon. There is no end run around God's holiness to get to his love. You have to go through knowing God's holiness and our sinfulness to get to love. Woe is me, Isaiah said, because I'm a sinful man and I've seen the Lord. John Calvin, who's kind of the philosophical leader of Presbyterians, he starts off his whole book on who God is with the idea that the more we know God, the more we know ourselves. And then the more we know ourselves, the more we know God. And so, and that's what this whole sermon series is actually all about. That the first Sunday, you know, the more we know that God has revealed himself to us, that God is knowable, the more we know that ourselves, that we are the people that he has revealed himself to, and that makes us impressed with ourselves. And then we realize that God will have no other God before us, that God is jealous, no idols, and we look at our life and we say, wow, oh my gosh, there's lots of idols in our lives. We need to get them out. And then we go to this week, and it's that, you know, God is holy, and we realize that we're not holy. But then it's going to come around again, and then we're going to end it where God is love, and God loves us no matter what. And then we realize that we're loved, but it's this circular way of understanding both God and ourselves. I think he was right. So the good news is that the holiness of God heals us. Woe is me, says Isaiah. But then what happens? Remember, a seraph brings a coal from the altar where sins are forgiven, the place of atonement. And with that coal, he touches his lips and he understands the grace of God. He is forgiven. And so for Isaiah at this point, God's grace is no longer theoretical. It burns away his guilt. See, Isaiah really hadn't understood, like any of us in his place would have. He hadn't understood the depth of his sin and the amount of the grace that was needed. But Isaiah sees clearly his sins at that point, their awfulness and the grace of God that covers his sin. You know, it's like having a kid and you realize, boy, this is a lot harder than my parents made it look. And at some point you call them up and you say, you know, thanks for letting me live. And for putting up with me when I was a teenager. Because honestly, there were times if my parents had killed me, the law would have deemed that a justifiable homicide. So I want you to hear me clearly. Unless you're wounded, unless you're pained by God's holiness, you will never be healed by his grace. This is the problem with our previous denomination. They wanted the love of God without the holiness of God. And it doesn't work like that. Everyone has to go through this valley of understanding the depth of their sin to really understand the greatness of God's grace. Because if God only loves, there is no holiness. There is no power of forgiveness and grace. God absolutely welcomes you with open arms. Yes, God loves you. That youth pastor was correct. But until you see he's a holy God of power, infinitely exalted, the God who is able to create and destroy with a single word, unless you see he's that sort of God, rather than one you control, you will never be shaken to your core by his love for you. Here's the last thought. The holiness of God renews us, renovates us, transforms us. Look at Isaiah again. He gets his lips touched with that coal. He's seen God's holiness. He's been awestruck. He has understood the depth of his sin and the greatness of God's grace and forgiveness, and God didn't have to give him any of that at all. And then what happens? God says, I've got a job for you. I'm going to send you to stubborn people who rarely listen. I need someone to speak for me for decades who's going to be ridiculed. He's going to be despised. He's even going to be chased. Your life will be in danger. You'll get no support from anyone. Are you interested? And Isaiah says immediately, here I am, send me. Why would Isaiah do that? That sounds like a terrible, awful job. Because Isaiah has been freed by God's holiness and the grace. He's not afraid to be labeled a failure because he knows God. He's been freed from his fears. He's been freed from his concerns. He's totally free. Freedom in the Bible is personal holiness. It's the holiness of a human heart responding to the holiness and grace of God. It brings courage to Isaiah. It brings courage to me. It brings courage to you. If you finally realize that God is a God so holy that even the angels surrounding him smolder and burn and smoke in his presence, you know, the seraphs, literally that means the burning ones, that even they have to cover their eyes. And that God is for me. That God loves me. What can I possibly be afraid of? And so here comes the courage and peace. See, the Bible mentions very clearly that this happened in the year that King Uzziah died. He'd been king for 52 years, and there was going to be a hard time of transition to the next king. But for Isaiah, he isn't worried like the rest of the Jews, because the real king has come to him and made himself known to Isaiah. You know, there was a trick about 20, 30 years ago, maybe it still happens, that psychologists would use for people who struggle with worry and anxiety. They said, put a rubber band on your wrist, and whenever you feel nervous or worried, you pull it out and you snap it, and you tell yourself that worry never helps. I have to say, in contrast, the Bible says you don't need tricks like that. I mean, some of us may even feel right now like we're living in a year like the year that King Uzziah died. Lots of turmoil and trouble. And the Bible says, look to God. Hear God say, if I'm your king, and in spite of my holiness, I have accepted you through the grace I've given you, then you really can take courage. You don't need a shortcut anymore to tell you not to worry. We need to repent before the holy and mighty God. There are no shortcuts to Jesus. That youth pastor had been taught a shortcut, and I was sorry about that. A shortcut to God's love, and really that's all he had to offer. But for us, when we meet God's holiness, we are in awe of him. We receive the sacrifice on the altar of Christ himself, which has the power to transform us. We become holy as well. Not of our own power, but through Christ our Savior. Let me pray for us and prepare ourselves for communion through confession. Jesus, we don't like often to think about your holiness and how holy you are and how not holy we are, because that really kind of gets at the core of who we are, that we think we're pretty good people. But the truth is, compared to you, we're nothing. We're rags, but we're dearly loved rags. And so we are grateful for your holiness and ask that you would continue to use it to transform us and our understanding of you and how available we are to you for your molding and shaping. And in that, Lord, we are reminded to come before you in confession, and so we do. Lord, lead us in our own confessions as we come before you, the things that need to be confessed, the things that we have said, the things that we have done, the things that we have left undone because we were otherwise occupied. Lord, hear the confessions of our hearts. Heavenly Father, we lift up our lives to you as we understand a little bit better that you're holy and we just aren't. And there's so much in our lives that we could say, This is where I've fallen short. This is where I wish I was different. Lord, we apologize for the things that we have said that violate your holiness, the things that we have done that violate your holiness, the things that we've even thought that violate who you are, because that's not how you want us to be. We apologize, Lord, and ask for your grace to cover us again. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The good news of Scripture, of course, is that we are not perfect. The Scripture is very clear about that, but it's also very clear that we are graced, we are forgiven. God is good because of his holiness, but also because of his grace and forgiveness, which is new every morning. So I can tell you, because Scripture says that you are forgiven and God is good. Amen. So if you could get out your communion elements and celebrate communion with me. You might remember that on the night before Jesus was crucified, he was in the upper room and had celebrated communion, or rather had celebrated the Passover Eucharist with the disciples. And at the end of that time together, he gave them a new ritual. And he took up some bread, which is probably like this bread here, and he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is for you. Take and eat. So they did. So, please. please take and eat. And in the same way, he held up a cup that was full of the wine from the Passover. He said, this wine is my blood that is shed for you, shed for the forgiveness of sins, shed for the forgiveness of many. He says, as often as you eat of this bread and drink from this cup, you remember my death until I come again. So I invite you to eat and drink and remember. We're going to sing two verses right now of "O Love That Will Not Let Me Go."
Sitting for a while, and I invite us to stand for our closing song this morning, "Nothing But the Blood."
Nothing but the blood of Jesus, all precious is the flow that makes.
So let me end with a benediction. We're going to do, I give the benediction, and then we have a song to sing, and food is getting ready, so you can, if you're quick, you can get the food first and still listen to the song. Let me end us with a prayer, and I'll pray for the food so you can get right at it. How about that? We'll be up there. Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for yourself. Thank you for your holiness, and thank you for your grace. Lord, send us out from this time to enjoy good food and good fellowship. Bless us, Lord, always to your glory. Send us out with your hope, with your peace, and with your freedom. And the people of God say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, we have the national anthem to sing. There are actually four verses in this song. And I just want you to imagine this writer. He's a young lawyer. He is on a British ship trying to negotiate the release of American prisoners that have been taken captive, and they are in the worst conditions possible. People are dying on this ship. Even the British soldiers themselves were trying to flee and even join the armies of America because they were better life, quality of life. And so he is watching off the shores of Maryland, the bombs going. It looks like daylight, it's the middle of the night, and he starts penning these words, and he gets through a couple of verses, and he's just thinking about what America's going through, the bloodshed, that people are free and they're fighting for freedom, that people are not free and they're fighting for their freedom. Some of them, many of them, will die and never experience freedom, and they're still fighting for something they'll never get personally, but that you and I enjoy today. And so the act of God is what causes the tide to turn for the Americans to win this war, because it is odds 3-1. The Americans are outnumbered, and because God sends a rainstorm, a heavy rainstorm and fog, the British they send these shells, these mortar shells, and they just sink and sizzle in the mud. They don't do anything. It even hits the roof of Fort McHenry, and it does nothing. It just puts a little dent in it. And so it was the weather and God's act that allowed this war to be won on the American side. And so we sing together the national anthem. We'll do verse 1 and 4.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming.
let's end by singing God Bless America. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the ocean wide with hope.
Welcome, folks.
Thank you.
Glad you could join us.
Yeah.
This is Michael's friend.
This is actually Justin's friend.
Yeah, this is Owen. They're actually friends with Swami and Diana and JR. Yeah, so we're actually from Los Altos. We grew up here, but then we moved to San Jose. My dad still lives here. And and we're staying at my dad's temporarily because tomorrow we're moving to Arizona. So, yeah, so this was a really nice, you know, we're getting in the car tomorrow and the family is moving. So it was really, really special to be able to. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so. But I know Slobby, they love coming here. Diana, and they're just really look forward to Sunday. I think she said one other time a week. Yeah.
So they live at Lisa's dad's house.
Yeah.
I hear you guys are leaving us and going to the middle of the desert.
Yeah.
In the summer.
We hear it's pleasantly warm there.
It depends on your definition.